people! It is a podcast divided. We're in a line of scrimmage between Michigan and Michigan State fans here on social media and in the virtual universe. I am Don of the winning Michigan Wolverines. We finally got a win after a whole month. I am elated. Not really. I mean, I'm all right. I'm just kind of over-exaggerating.
Was it a win, though?
Well, technically, it was a win.
Technically. I mean,
it was a...
Emotionally, it was probably more of a loss.
I mean, it was a moral loss.
Yeah,
but moral. It was a on paper victory.
Yeah.
So, but we'll. I mean, having the W in the win column is better than an L. That's how I feel. And then, of course, this is the guy, the dissenting person, is Connor Muldowney. Yes.
Watching it as an outsider. And if I was Michigan, I came into the season with all these expectations, and I'm 1-3. Are they 1-3 or were they 1-3 before?
They're 1-3, yeah.
And I'm looking down the barrel at a 1-4 start, and I need triple overtime to beat Rutgers. I feel no better about that win than I did if they had lost. I mean, I don't know if I'd feel anything. I don't know if I would feel elation. It was probably a relief. From you guys more than anything. But I would say, like, knowing you, I don't think that you feel better about winning there than you did if they had lost in triple overtime.
Honestly, it was very, very necessary for me to readjust expectations, especially after the Michigan State game. My expectations were readjusted because after the way Michigan looked at Minnesota and how good we thought they were, I'm thinking maybe we can sneak into the New Year's Six. And if we surprise Ohio State, we're in the playoff. That's your thought. Mm-hmm. After that game, I realized that, hey, this team needs work. And then Indiana kind of confirmed that. So my expectations have been adjusted. And after that game, I was like, I'm looking for improvement. Because this is a kind of a throwaway season. It's an abbreviated season. There's no one loses eligibility. It's pretty much like it's a glorified preseason. I mean, technically, it counts as everything, but it's a glorified preseason. So what I was looking for out of this team was fight. I was looking for improvement, and that's really what I was looking for. And honestly, with how close that game was, I wanted a win. Mm-hmm. And because a win, especially with a young team that's still trying to find itself, a win is a good thing because you can go home and get on that plane feeling good about yourself. And like I said, it really doesn't. It doesn't matter how it looks to everybody else on the outside. It's about how you feel, and how it's about self-esteem. It's a collective self-esteem, and self-esteem is how you esteem yourself, not how writers esteem you, not how fans esteem you, not how fans of opponents esteem you. You have to esteem yourself, and I think it was great for their collective self-esteem. And so I mean, as an outsider, because like I said, you watched the game as an outsider. How did you feel like just seeing how really everything changed when Cade McNamara got in the game?
Well, let me start off by saying a win is a win unless it's Rutgers. That's what I'll say.
Fair enough, man.
Or Nebraska. Same. Rutgers or Nebraska. And
Fair enough. I'll let you have that one.
Back to your question. But I mean, we lost to Rutgers. So like, I have no room to talk on the Rutgers point. But I'm just saying, a win is a win unless it's Rutgers. Okay, back to the Cade McNamara. When he came in, I mean, it's been clear that Joe was hyped up and unfairly, put on this pedestal that I think that it messes with your head. You've talked about it before. It messes with your head. They crown him like preseason Heisman. They put him like top five in the Heisman rankings and in Vegas after one game. And it was all of this stuff that got to his head. I think I knew. The minute that he said that he didn't know who Antoine Simmons was, I was like, this dude is way bigger in his mind than he actually is on the field. So that's, I'm not super shocked at his downfall. And Cade McNamara, he sees the opportunity. I mean, he did something that every backup quarterback who's a young guy, who's just waiting for the opportunity, he did what everybody dreams of doing. But he happened to do it against Rutgers, so we don't know how much stock to put in it.
Yeah.
But like, this is back to your original point before the season began. You have to treat Cade with,
yes.
He's very delicate right now.
Yes.
You tell him how good he is and you'll shatter him. Just, I mean, people are doing it right now. I mean, after they saw him, he played great. He looked great. He looked like a way better quarterback. He hit all of his throws. He didn't make any mistakes. You know, he was accurate all game long, and that's something that Michigan hasn't had all season, really. But people are going to be like, you're the guy. You're the savior. You're the next guy, and that's going to get in his head. But if people don't do that, I think he'll be fine. But, absolutely. I mean, also J.J. McCarthy is going to get to campus next year. And
yeah, and I, honestly, that's a great analysis. Because the ish thing with Joe is Joe Milton came from an offense that in a program that wasn't very modern. I'll say that it wasn't the mod, because a lot of these high school quarterbacks running college offenses in high school. So when they get to college, it's similar terminology, similar system, similar concepts. But Joe, I'm not sure if he ran a wing T or a double or a two back, you know, old school pro style system. I'm not sure if he did that, one of those things, but it was a very rudimentary offense with rudimentary terminology. And so Joe didn't have all the personal quarterback tutelages and stuff. So Joe came to Michigan raw as can be with a lot of physical tools. And it's really took him 2 years to even get ready to where, hey, we trust him to put him in the game. And even right now, it's Joe with this particular offense. Joe is still very talented, and he still has a lot of room to grow and still plenty of time to get himself right. But right at this point right now, Joe is doing more thinking than he is reacting. And in this offense, especially with the offensive line being as porous as it is, the receivers being as young as they are, you have to get the ball out of your hands. But if you try to process things in your head and try to go back to what you learned in on the chalkboard and in your meeting and or watching film, instead of just reacting, you're sacked. You are eating the tire grinds of the turf. So, you know, if you do that. But Joe still needs to continue to prepare, because he's still one play away from having to go back in there. Yep. And when he goes back in, he has to be ready. But Kay did an outstanding job. The one thing Kay did, Kay had confidence. He was cool. And what he did was he got the ball out of his hand. Like, pop, 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 pop. I mean, please don't mean that. That's what he did. He's got the ball out of his hand. And when he did that, and they started moving the chains with those short passes, you know, it opened up the deep ball, and it opened up the running lane. And Hassan Haskins and Zach Charbonnet need to be the 1-2. And let the other guys kind of go around that, because Hassan Haskins is a runner, and so you see the improvement. But at the same time, Michigan has to be careful not to put all this pressure on Cade McNamara, because if he has a bad game, you're gonna throw him in the trash like you did Joe. You're gonna throw him in the trash like you did Shea. You're gonna throw him in the trash like you did Wilton, and the list goes down all the way to Brian Greasy, and then beyond that, because Michigan fans, as John U. Bacon said, Michigan fans are not happy unless they're unhappy. So
I have two thoughts on Joe and Michigan as a whole.
Okay.
Number one, Joe, I think, will be a good quarterback. He still has a chance to be a really good quarterback.
Yes.
One day. I just don't think it's at Michigan.
I think that's a fair assessment.
That with what Michigan has in Cade, and then what they have coming in with J.J., I think it's going to be very, very difficult for him to improve that quickly, because I think Harbaugh feels the pressure of, I need to win now, and I can't be, you know, spending all this time on a project. And, you know, they might have that candid conversation this offseason, be like, you might be better off, you know, going to a program that is willing to work with you, give you the reins right away, and work through those bumps and bruises. Yeah. That's number one. I don't think he'll be at Michigan next year. Number two, I think that Michigan's defense is the worst I've seen it in over a decade.
About a decade, yeah.
I mean, Don Brown's job has to be on the line every single week. I watched Michigan give up, you know, they made Noah Vedrell look like a Heisman contender. I mean, he made a fourth down play to send it to overtime in regulation to tie it up, the tying touchdown, two-point conversion. He made a pass that never would have been completed like 2-3 years ago. And he gave up a two-point conversion that the quarterback dragged four guys into the end zone. I mean, that those two things cannot happen with a sixth-year defensive coordinator, whatever year, sixth-year defensive coordinator.
Absolutely. And yeah, I am with you on that 100%. Honestly, that fourth down play, the draw would have been, he would have been buried in the turf. Yeah. They'd have had to get a shovel or a digger and dig him out of the
I mean, didn't he throw the ball over the middle of the field too? It was like he kind of just like threw it into traffic and the guy caught it.
The guy just caught it. Yeah. It's just, yeah, the issue right now is, like I said, I've gotten to spend time and talking to Don Brown. I love him. He is the coolest dude you'll ever meet. He's very candid. He's an open book. You ask him anything, he will tell you. Like, after I talked to him after a game last year, like, when everyone was gone, it was just me and him, and then Campanelli, the other coach, he was just giving me, he kind of broke the game down, and here's what I did, talking about Ohio State and what he's got to do to prepare for them with Justin Fields, even though the game was months away. I mean, it was a great conversation. The issue with Don Brown is there are two things that are absolutely essential for Don Brown's defense to work. Number one, a dominant, relentless pass rush. Mm-hmm. Michigan doesn't have that right now, especially let alone with Aiden Hutchinson and Quiddy Pay and now Cam McGrone around. So, you know, the linebacker who blitzes a lot, Cam McGrone. Mm-hmm. You know, those guys are out. Because back when he first got there, he had a wealth of NFL players on all levels that were just attack. And then number two, you have to have two corners that can play on islands. And from Jordan Lewis to Channing Stribling to David Long to LaVert Hill to Ambry Thomas, all five of those guys are NFL cornerbacks. Mm-hmm. You know, guys that are going Ambry will be in the NFL soon. And those are guys you can put on islands. And guys that are good, and I mean, Michigan, I think, for either 1 or 2 years, had the number one passing defense in all of college football.
Yeah, that was their thing, and now that's their weakness.
And because right now, Michigan's cornerbacks are not, because they're not guys that are able to play on islands at this point from a technique standpoint, and with no spring practice, no fall practice, non-conference games. Basically, you're throwing these kids who really don't have a lot of experience dead into the fire, and you're seeing the fruits of that. So, and it's really, really hard to adjust schematically, especially when you've got to get ready for the next opponent. You can't just go and teach fundamentals and tech, which you would do in spring ball. That's why it's a transitional year. And because of the optics, I think you have to. Don's a great, great dude. I love him, but it may be that time to where you allow him to retire, amicably. You know, amicably, because he has done a lot of good for Michigan. But sometimes, just like those vegetables in your refrigerator, they go as good and healthy as they are. They go bad. Happens.
They don't want a Mark D'Antonio situation. That's what I'll leave it on. They don't want that where he plays boys club with all these guys that he's friends with, and he doesn't want to let him go, even though he knows that he probably should, but he's close with them. It's time to kind of save your own job here and make the moves necessary to contend.
You got to do it. He has made moves. I give him credit for that. He as Mike Valenti says, you put a bullet in Tim Drevno, his guy from day one at San Diego. He's really done. He's really made the moves to try to put them in position. So I give him credit, but from the looks of it, there's more moves need to be made. Hopefully the team continues to grow and develop and really get better and really head into 2020 with a running start. That's what you're looking at right now. That's all you can have right now. And hopefully Jim has his momentum and his swag back. I mean, I was very encouraged to see Coach very enthusiastic, especially after, you know, the proverbial gun jammed whenever that field goal was missed, when we would have lost to Rutgers, and it would have been a really, really bad thing. So
Rutgers wanted to lose that game so bad. They had so many chances.
They had us. I mean, they had us a few times, and
Rutgers just turned back into Rutgers. That's really what it was. They're like, oh wait, we're Rutgers. Yeah. And then they're like, here's your win.
Hey, Michigan needed it in the worst way. Penn State's coming up this week. You all have Northwestern who's playing really good football under Pat Fitzgerald. We'll talk more about that later. But here, here's the thing. It is basketball season starts tomorrow, man. Two top 25 teams that hopefully won't shoot themselves in the foot. You know, hopefully COVID, wear your mask.
Yep.
We'll be able to, you know, hold off and people will be able to stay healthy and have a good basketball season. So
we need basketball in our lives.
Yes, we do. And we have a couple of treats for you all. We have from Michigan State and really a universal basketball savant, DeShaun Tate of Tate's Takes is coming up next. And then after him, we've got Coach Saddi Washington, assistant coach from the University of Michigan. I'm going to be able to kind of help give you some insight on the season, maybe a little personal story as well. So we're looking forward to basketball. Once again, you are watching a podcast about it. We will see you soon. Welcome to back to a podcast divided. We are the line of scrimmage or the half court line or the blue line, whatever sport between Michigan and Michigan State fans. And yeah, just been talking about at least one of our teams this week got a win. And like I said, for the first time all year, Both Michigan nor Michigan State lost in football, so that is a celebration.
Yeah, great week. I loved not being able to watch anything this weekend. It was great.
Yeah, even though it was the game was very painful with Michigan.
You didn't like that overtime?
W is better than an L. It was ugly as heck, but a W is better than an L. We'll take it, but I don't want to be rude to our guest. We have a special guest, DeShaun Tate, the author and publisher of Tate's Take. He is a college basketball aficionado and a Michigan State grad. And he's here to talk some college basketball because we need some relief from this football season. DeShaun, how you doing, man?
I'm outstanding. Thank you so much for the introduction, allowing me to share, you know, thanks for sharing the space with me in general. And I actually, you know what, because Michigan State didn't play, I kind of feel like that should go as a victory.
Oh, yeah.
That's the way I'm feeling. If you can feel good off of a 4 overtime victory, then I can feel good over not being able to play. So
that is fair. That is absolutely positively fair. But also, you should be appreciative of us because we were able to exact revenge on Rutgers for the state of Michigan. So,
Well, I appreciate of you for us having our one win on the season. I was kidding with somebody else earlier on my 11-hour drive or ride up here to Michigan, which is freezing cold, by the way. Not that that surprises anybody, but true. I say all that to say that you know, I was talking to my cousin who's a Michigan fan too, and you know, I said, listen, I'm sure I'm not the only one that's saying this, I can lose all the rest of the games throughout the duration of the season. I needed the one I got. And got a nice little trophy standing in the china cabinet with a guy that's wearing a flannel shirt with his hands hips and an axe in his beard as long as mine.
Yeah, this is the rare year where it's like a rebuild. We knew it was going to be a rebuild. We knew Michigan State wasn't going to be that good. We kind of figured, you know, if they can beat Michigan, I'm all right with that. I wasn't expecting anything else, so I'm good with it too.
Hey, you're going to get a win? You know.
Get the win.
Yeah, he's going to get the win, and maybe Michigan can pass some hocus-pocus magic in a few weeks, but I'm not counting on it. Moving on to college basketball. College basketball starts tomorrow. Man, I'm excited, and both teams, both Michigan and Michigan State, are in the top 25 and have good teams coming back. You got Rocket Watts, namely coming back for Michigan State. You've got Isaiah Livers coming back from Michigan, along with a couple of key transfers on each side. So it's going to be a great year. It's going to be a really fun year, interesting year, and hopefully COVID behaves. So, DeShaun, kind of what's your outlook on Michigan State, because that's your team, and really kind of overall college basketball?
I'll be honest with you, man. I'm under the impression, first of all, and this is not trying to just kind of overlook the season or anything like that, but if I'm just being realistic, because that's the only way I know to be, I kind of feel like for a lot of people, considering the recruiting class or likely to be recruiting class for the next year or two, people are just kind of looking forward to that and kind of overlooking this one. At least I feel like that's the vibe, that's the energy that I kind of get from a lot of people. Now, that's not to say that, Sparty can't make a deep run in the NCAA tournament or anything like that. Are they going to win a national championship? Probably not. But they're also a team that you never really want to look past during a certain time of the year. So outside of that, I really think it's just about developing players more than anything. I know that the seniors would probably respectfully disagree with me on that. But just want to keep our eyes on a few players. You know, the point guard spot is kind of thin and up for grabs a little bit. You got Rocky Watts, who I expect to play that position and start at it from day one. And then, of course, there's been a lot of talk and buzz around town about Foster Lawyer and how much he has really improved. I certainly hope so, because after 2 years behind arguably the best point guard in the country last year, he's going to need to come and show and prove some of that. So I'll be interested to see where his confidence level is from that standpoint. I know everybody's yelling about Aaron Henry and how, you know, how high their expectations are of him this year. Mine a little bit more so of Gabe Brown. I think he's a little underappreciated sometimes, underrated. And a guy like Marcus Bingham Jr. It really has to have a big year this year, because you know, it's getting slimmer and slimmer for him as they keep recruiting bigger and bigger guys coming in, and he needs to have that breakout year this year. So I don't know. We'll see. I'm looking forward to it.
Those are all pretty fair. I mean, I'm with you on the point guard position is going to be like my number one focus. I'm curious to see, because I know Rocket's not really a pure point, and he played a lot of two last year. I'm curious to see if he can have the same playmaking ability as Cassius. I know he's more of a scorer, more of a shooter. But I mean, Cassius was also a shooter and a scorer, but Rocket is like a natural born, you know, he'll put the ball in the basket often. But I agree with the Gabe Brown. I think Gabe Brown is way underrated. Ever since he got sick at Wisconsin and he played like 1 minute and didn't play the rest of the game, he just never looked the same from that point of the season on. And I think confidence had a lot to do with that. He could shoot the ball. If he makes like close to 40% of his threes, he's going to be a really effective player for Michigan State. And I've been on the Marcus Bingham bandwagon, and I've been holding out hope for 2 years now. And I think this is the year we finally see Bingham become somebody. And I kind of compare it to an Adrian Payne situation, where Payne, people called him a bust for 2 years, and you know, he had all this potential, all this talent. He was just too skinny. He couldn't, you know, stick with the lineup. His conditioning wasn't good. And then he blossomed as a junior and a senior. So I'm hoping that we have that kind of rise out of him. He still needs to eat about 50 more cheeseburgers a day for him to be, you know, even worthy of a post spot in the Big Ten. But
I'll be his nutrition coach.
Don, you take care of him, you know, get him whatever he needs. And
I wish I had his problem.
Yeah,
Well, you know what? Not necessarily. And I'll tell you what. Everybody says I'm 36 years old. I'm 150 pounds, soaking wet with rocks in my pocket. And it's been that probably since high school. So it's not the easiest thing to put pounds on, man, just like it's very difficult to lose them. But I will say enough to say It's crazy how you have people like that you have a guy like a Zion Williamson, who probably eats salad and still gains weight. And then you have, you know, guys like me and Marcus Bingham, who, you know, eats everything in the world and loses weight. You know, it's just weird the way that stuff works out sometimes. But he definitely doesn't need to be passing up any, you know, buffet bars or anything.
Get him to Golden Corral ASAP.
Yeah, for sure. But, you know, but for it to be somewhat good weight, you know, again, like I say, somewhat.
Have you seen the pictures of him that kind of surfaced when he posted, like, they had a Michigan State picture day, and he posted, like, the upper body of him looks bigger. I don't know if you've seen it. I posted the picture on my Twitter. I don't know. I'll try to send it to you after, but his upper body at least looks muscular, toned. Like, he looks like he's kind of added some good weight to his frame. The lower body, I didn't see anything. I don't think the picture showed that, but that's kind of a concern because he's got chicken legs, but he looks bigger.
Well, I'll say this much. just in terms of, you know, first of all, with it being basketball and you being that tall and being down on the block, and I know he's a good shooter from outside and all that cute stuff, but, you know, it's just like anything else. If you, a car isn't going to drive if you don't have wheels. So if he doesn't have that lower body to match the upper body that I guess he's improved or filled out into a little bit more now, I'm not sure how much good it's, I'm not going to say how much good it's going to do him. Of course, any amount of pounds for him, I guess, is good. But I just hope that he's equally, you know, working on the lower body strength and things like that, too. I haven't seen that picture. But you know what? There's a lot of stuff that, you know, we're seeing and that we're hearing. And it's so much optimism and positivity around it. But at the end of the day, we've got to get on the floor. You know, we've heard so many good things about Joshua Langford and him coming back and how he feels like he's in the best shape of his life. And, you know, the confidence level of Foster Lawyer and the weight gain from this guy. At the end of the day, it's going to come and have to show on the floor. And that's really all that these guys are ultimately going to be judged on, not necessarily, you know, what happens in practice or before the season starts.
Totally agree.
Absolutely. And just kind of from my perspective with Michigan State, I think Rocket Watts is more suited to play the wing. I mean, he's a natural wing off-ball guy where he can kind of set up in his spot and be able to kind of set up in his spot and take and drive or shoot however he feels and kind of have that freedom instead of having to have the ball and be a distributor and reading the floor. Because it's a lot – I'm sure he can do it, but I think with the type of player that he is, it's easier for him to hunt his shot when he's off the ball where he can move around a little bit and kind of pick his spots on the floor. That's why I think if Foster Lawyer – has improved, and I think defensively is the biggest aspect of it because he can shoot the lights out. I mean, I remember he had those 5 threes in the Big Ten tournament back in 2019. The guy can shoot the ball. So I think if he can be a distributor and somebody that can be dependable and give good minutes, I think that's going to be a huge bonus for Michigan State going into this season, and especially during tournament time because they're going to be in the tournament. Death taxes Tom Izzo in March. So – that's going to happen. So I think Foster Lawyer is a very key small cog. What do you think, DeShaun?
That, you know what, I definitely agree with that for sure. And you know what, it almost has the feel in terms of Rocket playing point guard. It almost has the feel of a young Joshua Langford going in there and expecting for him to play point guard to an extent. You know, it just has that same feel because we know he's more combo and more of a scoring guard and like that. And to be honest with you, it's something that I think can be done because I personally think that he's a little bit more of a natural point than Matt McQuaid was, who I feel like just from a coordination dribbling standpoint.
I don't ever want to hear Matt McQuaid's name again.
Yeah. Well, I tell you what, like I say, I mean, if we're talking dribble, dribble, handoff, okay, that's fine. You know, if you're getting ripped on that, you might not deserve a roster spot. But, and he did a good job, you know, fairly good job for, you know, the amount of time that he had to do it. But this has been a situation, I don't think that we've ever had this many question marks, and I could be totally wrong, about Michigan State at the point guard position. And I don't know how old you guys are, so I might be showing my age a little bit, but probably since Allen Anderson was forced to play point guard at like 6'6", 220 pounds, like a legit small forward, legit being naturally, and he was forced to play that point guard position. And until Drew Neitzel came speed, Allen Anderson was manning that position. So it just – and that just dawned on me just now, actually, come to think of it. So it just kind of reminds me of that a little bit.
I think that – what we're kind of looking past here is that State still has a third point guard option and AJ Hoggard. I mean, he's kind of a combo guard too, but he can handle the ball. And I think the one thing that is so underrated about Rocket that could help him develop into a really good point guard is his handles are out of this world. We saw him put people on skates constantly last year, and he's so deceptive with the ball in his hands that I think that alone is going to help him, you know, when it comes to playmaking or, you know, trying to get guys open. He could juke past a guy, you know, force another defender to come up, kick it out. It's things like that that people don't really realize that Rocket is in. He can be an elite ball handler And while we haven't really seen him take the ball off the floor that often, that's something that's going to play to his advantage, and that's going to help him when it comes to, you know, who gets minutes at the point, Foster or Brockett. And, you know, Foster's not really the most deceptive ball handler. He's not exactly going to juke you out of your shoes. He probably pump fake you and you won't fall for it type of thing. But I think we'll see lineups with Foster and Rocket, but I think Rocket is going to get a lot more point guard minutes than people really think.
Yeah. You have to. I mean, think about it, is you have to do that. Mm-hmm. Just about getting you got to get a lot of times in college basketball by getting your best five on the floor, especially with Langford's return, because I think he's going to command minutes as well. So, you know, really, especially when you go small, because you can put Aaron Henry at the four. You know, so I'm with that lineup. So, yeah.
Defense. I mean, no offense, Foster, you can't play defense. Like, if you're putting five guys on the floor who could play defense, which is arguably Tom Izzo's most, I mean, he's more passionate about defense, I feel like, than offense by a long shot. And if you're not giving the defensive effort, if you're not making an impact on defense, Foster's not going to see the floor. I mean, you look at Rocket is a top tier defender around the perimeter. We saw that last year. Aaron Henry is a very good defender. Josh Langford, before he got hurt, was a really good defender. So that's three guys right there. You're going to put Foster Lawyer in over one of those guys when they're playing against, you know, a top wing in the Big Ten or a top guard in the Big Ten? No. So, I mean, that alone, defense alone, is going to kind of create a gap there.
Y'all hear that?
What's that?
No,
Oh, you're doing surfing? Okay, here we go. The Foster Lawyer surfboard? Okay, all right.
What is that?
The whole Trey Jones treated him like a surfboard in that one fast break.
Yeah, I didn't see
that. I'm sorry. I couldn't resist.
I was at that game. the one here at Breslin, I guess, you guys imagine is talking about. And see, and that kind of goes back to that. It's one thing to not be good at to not be that good at defense, but it's a whole nother thing to just be small and not at defense. Yeah. And I think that that's something that obviously hurts him, and it's not something that he can control. The only thing he can control is what he can control, and I think that that is the extra effort. I don't think that I don't see him not giving defense effort. I don't think that's the issue. I think the issue just that the effort he gives, it's just not good. If that's his best, then that's a problem.
Yeah.
Besides that fact, I mean, listen, I'm 150 pounds and I'm 5'10". Okay, I get it. You know, it's hard to stay. And I feel like I'm a pretty good defender. Not that I'm like this All-American or, you know, Mr. Basketball for Michigan or anything like that. But if you're coming over here to play at this program, you can not be all that good at certain things, but defense is one of the things that you're going to have to be good at, or you're going to come over here and sit next to me. And that's just what it, when it comes to this, we could take losses with it. If you come with your best and it's satisfactory, then I think that they'll be okay, you know, but when you're not, when you just don't really have much of a leg to stand on, and it's essentially when the team is on the team in green is on the defensive side of the ball, when he's on the floor and it's starting to feel like it's 5-on-4, they've got a different set of problems on their hands.
That happened quite a bit last year. I felt like the second Cassius came out, whoever they were playing would go on like an 8-0 run and just
lick my chops.
Yeah, exactly. They would attack that. But I will tell you one thing that he's going to be elite at on the defensive side of the floor, and he's going to be an elite charge taker.
That's exactly elite. What I was thinking.
He will be elite. And Rush will feel so bad for him because he's probably going to be, you know, whoever he's going against is probably going to have a good 5-6 inches and, you know, 40 pounds on him. So he's going to go flying. He's going to go from 3-point line to baseline in, you know, 0.3 seconds. So if that's one thing that I feel okay about, he's going to take a lot of charges this year. He's going to be Matt McCoy 2.0.
Yeah. Basically, if you're Foster Lawyer, just take charges.
Close the eyes. Close your eyes and take it.
Take charges, hit threes. You get playing time. You don't do one of those two things, you're going to be chilling, and you're going to be on senior day kissing the floor the last one to kiss the floor because you're going to be the last one to get in the game. So, yeah. Yeah, so, but yeah, I think, again, I think Michigan State, I never count on a Tom Izzo coach team because the thing is, even if they're deficient in talent, they are going to be very good. They're going to be, they're going to play hard. They're going to play steady defense and they're just going to annoy you to death. So I think they're going to be a great, but I want to kind of fast forward. I want to kind of go into your crystal ball. Cause I think a lot of Michigan State fans are very, very excited about the recruiting class over the next couple of years with Max Christie, Jaden Akins, and Pierre Brooks coming in next year and possibly a 2021 reclassification for the widely renowned Imani Bates. Like, I mean, what are your thoughts on that whole thing, man? That's a big coup from Tom Izzo.
Yeah. I think one thing that helps, you know, I bring a lot of people on my podcast and I do a special segment called Fast Break, or I'm sorry, not Fast Break. It used to be called that. It's called Quick Release. So I fire off probably about a good 10 questions where people answer either yes or no, or this player or that player or so on and so forth. And one of my questions lately has been, will Imani Bates play in a Michigan State uniform? Most of the people I have talked to have actually said no. And the reason that probably surprises me a little bit is because I'm not sure if people really realize how much COVID-19 has really set back changing the age restriction to go to NBA in terms of where it's at on the forefront of the decision makers and front offices minds of the NBA. Yeah. And then in addition to that, I guess the name, image, and likeness.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking, yeah.
How much of an effect that may actually play. So I guess it's something to be excited about. And I don't think just Imani Bates. I mean, even if Imani Bates doesn't see the floor for Michigan State, never suits up for green and white, I like to think that not only is it still a good recruiting class, regardless of who reclassifies or whatever, what have you, but it is essentially what could be, and I wouldn't put it past this, not saying Tom Izzo because I don't know him personally, but it could be something that's like, hey, commit here. We understand that you're probably not going to play here, but you making that decision is doing us a solid by being able to get other guys to come in.
Like LeBron to Ohio State.
I'm sorry?
Like LeBron to Ohio State, sort of.
Sure, absolutely. Because this is a guy that people want to play with. I mean, ironically enough, and I'm not sure how much you guys have ever heard this, there's people that work in this business that I've spoken to and brought them on my podcast. I've been reading their content for years since I was a little kid. And people that are respectful in this business. And I'm hearing people say that Imani Bates is the best high school player they've ever seen in their life. Now, number one, numero uno, rule of thumb, that's not DeShaun Tate saying that. That is these sources that are saying that.
Yeah.
But outside of that fact, I think that the recruiting classes is going to be good. And I want to make sure that I show some love because I'm always this person, as much as I may despise. Okay. The reality is this. They're not the only one with good recruiting classes. Okay. There's some other guys right up the road that got some pretty damn good recruiting classes themselves.
Yeah.
And I think that there's some people in green and white who really don't want to hear that or may cringe at that or has definitely in their own mind kind of taken a mental note but not really spoke about it much if they haven't been asked. But I'm going to speak up for them because this is something to be fearful of a little bit. And I know I should be probably speaking from a Michigan State standpoint, but the reality is this. I knew when Juwan Howard came in that he's going to get guys. When you have a guy who's likable, respectable, has a name that people can recognize, even if the kids don't, the parents do.
Yes.
African-American coach during this time of the year,
yes.
or everything that's going on in the world today, can pick up the phone and call LeBron James at any given point. And then even more so, while we still don't know what type of coach he is exactly, the good recruiter. I mean, Isaiah, once I saw Isaiah Todd verbally commit, it didn't matter what else they were going to land and actually play in maize and blue. It didn't matter if Josh Christopher, who was my favorite freshman coming into college basketball this year for Arizona State, it didn't matter that he chose not to go to Michigan. The reality is I knew what was to come in that time. It was going to put some pressure under Tom Izzo, kind of like the fries at the under the heat lamp at Mickey. But I think it applies some pressure. And I think that all of these guys between 2021 and 2022 for Michigan, 2021 and 2022 players for Michigan State, this is going to be a rivalry that I believe we've never seen anything like it. So I'm sorry to kind of bring it back around.
Absolutely. And this is a podcast divided. So And the best part about this whole thing, you know, I believe Izzo benefited from the Ed Martin scandal when Michigan was put on probation and Izzo cleaned up and just did what he did. But the good news is we saw under the Beilein era and then the era before the whole Ed Martin scandal is there's room in the state for both teams to be elite. You know, there's enough basketball talent in Michigan, surrounding Michigan, and Michigan and Michigan State are big enough names to bring in the best in the country. So I think it's just great for the rivalry. I wouldn't be surprised over the next 2-3 years if we have like a 1-2 versus 2 battle with Dick Vitale, or as long as he's around, he's gonna be there if it's an ESPN one. We just get to reserve ourselves to that, and it'd be like a 1-2 battle in Breslin post COVID with the full Breslin Center, and then come back on a CBS Sunday and have a game at Chrysler between a top 5 Michigan State. Man, I think it's gonna be great for our state. I believe that those days are coming, and just in being in practice, you know, I got to be in a close practice last year, with Juwan Howard and watch, you know, Saddi Washington, who's coming on later, is my old, summer coach from 20 years ago, and he's coaching in Michigan now. And he brought me into a basketball practice before a Michigan football game last year. And just to watch how relevant and relatable that Juwan is with the players, and how encouraging he coaches them, but he makes it fun, where he's just, or like the practice was 2 hours, but it was nonstop and it was all fun. It wasn't any fluff or any kind of, you know, boring or dead spots. And so I really believe with his style and his relatability, and shoot, he's done everything in basketball anybody wants to do. I really believe that he's gonna be a really, really great coach. He has a basketball IQ, but the good news about him, he's still a student of the game. He's still a student of the game. He's got Phil Martelli, got to hang with him for a little bit and talk with him. Great. He's one of the best mid-major coaches ever, and he's on the bench. You know, St. Joseph, you know, threw that right in our laps. And he's someone that he can learn from and lean on while he kind of learns and kind of really develops that callus of being a head coach in major college basketball. So it's only the beginning. It's exciting because both teams are going to be good. We're going to talk trash when we win. We're going to cry when we lose, but it's going to be a great time.
Here's my thing with Juwan. And I agree with both of you. I think he's probably an elite recruiter already, which is crazy to say since he's only been, you know, a college basketball coach for 1+ year. But the jury is going to be out until he gets these guys, these elite recruits on the floor playing at a high level. It's one thing to get these guys. We've seen coaches get guys before and just have terrible, you know, terrible seasons, terrible teams. Something just doesn't gel. We've seen it before. And we've seen coaches flame out even though they can recruit. Both football, both basketball and football. So, yeah, Juwan Howard's doing a great job off the court. He relates to the players. You know, if I was a young player and I saw Juwan Howard, you know, former NBA player, I'd be like, that's something to think about. But let's wait for him to coach a little bit. I mean, he has one season under his belt. They went, you know, they finished 9th place in the Big Ten, which is fine. I mean, 9th place in you know, top 3 wasn't a huge gap, but we just have to give it time. It's kind of like the Mel Tucker situation with the football team. You see all these recruits coming in. He's obviously, you know, he's got it on that side of the coaching spectrum. We got to see it on the field, and it's going to take like maybe not even two. It might take like 2-3 years for us to even know what kind of actual X's and O's coach he's going to be. But so far, I mean, yeah, he's striking fear into Michigan State on the recruiting landscape, but Michigan State's also responding with recruits of their own. You know, it is, like you said, it's going to be, we're going to see some elite battles between some like NBA guys real soon.
I kind of see it like this a little bit when it comes to that. I mean, again, kind of like and piggybacking off what you were saying, Connor, we don't know what kind of coach he is. You know, we had a really good feel of, oh my God, this could be something really special in the first couple weeks of the season last year after winning the Maui Invitational. And then it just kind of took a dip a little bit. But granted, I mean, that was the by far hand over fist, no questions asked, the best conference in the country last year. That's something that helped him. And, you know, it's crazy to even think about this because he's not the only one. You know, there's another guy named Penny Hardaway. Guys, and only had one season under his belt last year as well. Or I think last year was his second season, I believe. I think last year may have been his second season. I can't remember exactly. But actually, last year was his second season. But I say all that to say we still don't know what type of X's and O's he is. Yeah. I get a feeling that Juwan is a better X's and O's than Penny, but I'm not willing to just go out on the limb and whip the Sharpie marker out of my pocket and just kind of insert that in there just yet. Both of them very good, respectable recruiters, and both of them, I think, good coaches. Mm-hmm. Great coaches, I'm not willing to say that just yet. Very good coaches, I'm not sure I'm ready to say that just yet, but good so far, I can agree to that. And there's some other guys that have been in positions like them that, you know, had a more decorated NBA career and a longer coaching career in the NBA in terms of being on the bench as an assistant. One of them is Patrick Ewing, who just can't seem to get right. And he's at his alma mater as well. I think Chris Mullin was in that position. And we can go on and on and on.
Jerry Stackhouse, too.
Yeah, exactly. So we can go on and on and on with the names. But I will say, yeah, good point, Jerry Stackhouse. But I'll say enough to say that I think that Juwan is – I think that he's above all those other guys, and that kind of speaks volume for not only the University of Michigan, but when you start talking about the two best collegiate programs in any state, I would be curious to know who can really challenge Tom Izzo and Juwan Howard at this point. I mean, I know you're going to have your Chris Mack and Coach Cal and whatever, but I think that they're pretty high up there, and that speaks volumes.
You got Roy and Coach K, can't forget about that.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, of course, and I mean, that's granted, that one's a given. Of course, that's at the top of the list, but I'd be interested to see where Juwan Howard and Izzo kind of measure against some of those other guys, and I think that it would be pretty high, and that's a lot of credit to Juwan Howard after just 1 year, because I don't think it'll be like, well, most of this is all Izzo pretty much, you know.
If the start to his coaching career, like his recruiting, and if it keeps the trajectory is still, you know, going up for years and years, and if it doesn't plateau, like we don't know if this is a honeymoon period, you know, when young, vibrant coaches get hired sometimes, we see all these recruits jump on board. We saw that with Harbaugh. You know, everybody was so excited when he got to Michigan, you know, all these recruits jumped on board. They had top 10 classes, and then, you know, it can flame out, and then people call for your job in 5 years. So we don't know what that's going to be because, I mean, Juwan was left with a really good situation at Michigan.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, John Beilein coached the heck out of that program, and he got it to be one of the top two or three in the Big Ten consistently. So we kind of, that's another reason why I'm like, give it time. Like, Beilein's guys were all over that roster, all over that team. So wait till he gets his guys on campus, and then we'll talk. But if it keeps going as it is, like you said, this is going to be a top, you know, two or three coaching duo in the state, like in the same state in the country.
Absolutely. Like,
there's not going to be a better one other than, you know, Coach King and Roy.
Yeah. Yeah, DeShaun, before we part ways, like, what is, like, if you could be Nostradamus, how do you think this season ends for your beloved Michigan State Spartans?
I think that Sweet 16 is fair. I think that's – I'm not going to cap it off and say max. I don't think that that's minimum either. Would it surprise me to see this team go to the Elite Eight? No. depending on who's in the way on the way there. And obviously Tom Izzo does a good job at, you know, getting his guys prepared going into March every year and doing more with less. Would it surprise me to see them lose in the first round? That wouldn't surprise me either. So I think somewhere right in the middle between being a two and out and a Sweet 16 team. Of course, I'm kind of going to lean towards Sweet 16 a little bit more if I'm being realistic. Am I saying they're definitely not going to be a Final Four team? Of course not. I mean, I've seen other teams that were seven seeds, for crying out loud, go to the Final Four under Tom Izzo. But I say all that realistically to say, I think that Sweet 16 is fair. And of course, that's barring, you know, injuries or COVID or, you know, any of that type of stuff. But I think at
Wear
the
end mask.
Of yeah, seriously.
Yeah.
But I think the most important thing is about getting guys developed, making sure guys aren't leaving. Mm-hmm. And just trying to return for another season, because I'll be honest with you, would it surprise anybody if Rocket just completely tore it up or just did slightly better than mediocre and decided to make the jump? I mean, I don't think that would really, really, really surprise anybody for real. I mean, I honestly thought if he had a little bit more time on the floor last year, then he might have tried to do the exact same thing. So I'm not in Rocket's brain. We're not best friends. He didn't text me to tell me that thing, but I've seen crazier things. I mean, we are living in 2020 after all.
Yeah, we are. Man, DeShaun, you were outstanding tonight. Awesome. We were a lot of great content for our Michigan State followers and watchers and listeners, and to kind of digest while the season gets kicked off tomorrow. We appreciate you. How can people follow you on social media?
No doubt. At Tate's Take Hoops, man, on the Twitter as well as on the IG or the Gram or whatever you cool kids are calling it nowadays. At Take Hoops, T-A-T-E-S, T-A-K-E-H-O-O-P-S. We call it Where Basketball Lives. I like to think that, and no slight or dig to you by any means, but I like to think that it's the best, the most entertaining, the most informational, and the most educational basketball content on the planet in the form of a podcast. And so I tell people all the time, if it's 94 feet long, 50 feet wide, 22 feet, 1 3/4 inches on the perimeter, which is for college, 23 feet, 1 1/4 inches on the for the NBA. And if the rim is 10 feet tall, man, we cover it all, high school base, collegiate, pro, NBA, obviously, international. If people are rolling around in wheelchairs, shooting the ball in the hoop, dude, we're covering it. And I hope that the Michigan fans, the Maize and Blue fans that are listening to this podcast, you know, are satisfied. I'm not usually that nice about Michigan, so I hope that they're happy. But I like to just try and keep it real and be realistic. Knowing I'm coming on this podcast again, I don't want to do too much talking, but I do want to say you guys are doing such a great job, man. Keep up the grind.
Thank you.
Keep working. Keep hustling. Times are going to get tough. But just keep pushing, keep pressing, keep your foot on that accelerator, man. And you guys are doing such a great job. And thank you so much for sharing this platform with me in the space, man. I really do appreciate it. And tell Saddi that I said hello.
I will certainly do that. I
appreciate that.
And also tell Yoda that Yoda said, our friend Yoda, he told me that I got to build up the podcast before he comes on. So hopefully it built up enough where he'll come talk to us about his hoops, man, because he is the Swami of basketball.
Yeah, he's an even better guy, man.
Yes,
guy.
He is.
Shout out to Rashad Phillips, man, a great guy, and
yes, sir.
And came on my podcast last week and dropped some information and all that good stuff, man. So a really good guy, and we definitely got to do a good job at supporting one another. And so
absolutely,
I'm happy to have you guys on with me sometime to maybe come on and talk about Michigan State, Connor, and same thing for you for Michigan, and just really looking forward to doing some more projects in the future.
That sounds good. You know, we definitely got you on our Rolodex. So DeShaun, appreciate you. Next up, we got Saddi Washington, assistant coach for the University of Michigan. You're watching A Podcast Divided.
Welcome back, everyone, to A Podcast Divided. We are the line of scrimmage between Michigan and Michigan State Athletics. here. And hey, we've got someone on here that is literally right on that line. I've been on both sides of it. I want to introduce to you Michigan assistant basketball coach for the last 4 years, Saddi Washington. How are you doing, sir?
Doing great, Don and Connor. Appreciate you guys having me on this afternoon.
We're excited to have you. I know how busy you probably are right now, but this is big time.
Hey, we're all busy, my man. So, you know, we're always trying to work hard and trying to get another day closer to playing some basketball games. So that's the big part of it.
Fingers crossed.
Absolutely. And before Saddi was, you know, Michigan's assistant coach and Oakland's assistant coach among his high school, he was a great professional basketball player overseas. And but his claim to fame was he was Don Thomas's summer basketball coach 20 years ago when he was home for the summer from basketball. He would coach me, and I was a shooter. I wasn't very big. I wasn't very fast. All I could really do was shoot the ball. And my corner three-pointer was my shot. And whenever I got the ball in the corner, no one was on me, Saddi would yell, "Sweet spot!" And I would sink the three. So he really gassed me up, man. Made me feel like I was better than I was. So
hey, those hey, are one Connor, of he, that man doesn't know anything inside the three-point line. He was three-point line to three-point line, corner.
Three or nothing.
But that corner shot was butter.
Yeah. I had the nickname Corner Crook back in the day, just so you know. So we might have to have a little 3-point contest.
Yeah, I might have to have a shoot off, man. That would be great for your viewers, man. First party 3-point corner shoot off.
Tough. I haven't shot a basketball in 2 years.
Yes, indeed. Yes. Well, now we've got that out of the way. Coach, it's been a crazy year. I really felt, you know, just from you all really hit your stride late last season. And then right before you all were getting ready to play Rutgers in Indianapolis, they called it off, canceled the Big Ten tournament, canceled the NCAA tournament. There's just so much uncertainty with quarantining and stuff. So what the last really, really 8-9 months been like, really just kind of keeping your head above water? What's it been like?
Yeah, you know, Don, I think that, reflecting back, I think we were literally the last team or the first team that got pulled off the court. That's that Friday, I think it was, in Chicago. I mean, literally we walked out on the floor and was getting tuned up to play Rutgers, and then 20 minutes before the game, the plug got pulled. And you know, for the season to end so abruptly in such a way that none of us, like, you don't have the blueprint for that, you know. And most of the time there's somebody on the staff who's gone through something similar to this before, and so, you know, I think what it has really caused us to do in our profession, and I think in everybody's profession, is to hit the reset button. You know, I've been calling this a year of reset, where you go back, you do some self-evaluation on what's been working, what hasn't been working, how we all can be much more efficient. And with everything that's going on, from the pandemic to the social inequalities, you know, through the election, like, it's been an opportunity for us to really, as a program and as a team, set our culture in place for whenever the season comes. Because I've been saying everything's in pencil right now, you know, and as best as you can plan things and have it ready to go, it can change in a heartbeat. And Coach Juwan talks all the time about getting comfortable being uncomfortable. And so we just trying to prepare our guys. And he always says, embrace the suck. And that's what we're trying to do, so that whenever, you know, the season is ready to push play, Michigan Wolverines will be ready to go.
What was it like kind of telling the guys that you knew weren't coming back that there wasn't going to be, you know, an NCAA tournament, they weren't going to have a chance at a Final Four run?
Yeah, that was tough. And, you know, for us, that was our two seniors, Xavier Simpson and John Teske, two of the winningest all-time Wolverines in program history. And, you know, like Don said, we felt like we were, you know, kind of making our way back, ready to make a strong showing in the Big Ten tournament and on to the NCAA tournament. And it even sucked a little bit, Connor, for the new folks on staff who had never been to the NCAA tournament. It's March Madness is like no other. You know, I don't care what other sport it is, bowl game, you know, whatever it is, it's nothing like March Madness and the energy that brings, not just in basketball, but throughout the country. So for those kids to miss out on that opportunity was really devastating because, again, like that's their last shot, you know, like there is no opportunity for them to recapture that moment. And, you know, moving forward now, I think we're all in a little bit better headspace as it relates to kind of what I said before, embracing the suck, but you definitely just have to continue to control what you can control.
Absolutely. I can imagine that. And, you know, speaking of NCAA tournament, you know, just since you've been at Michigan, you actually made it to Monday night, you know, in San Antonio, Alamo Dome. I'm still hurting over that one. But we made it to that night. And when you're the last team standing, everyone's watching you. Yeah. With Coach Beilein, and you were made it there, and now you've got Coach Howard in, who's really brought up a new energy, a new fresh perspective. So, really, what has been the transition? What has the transition been like from Coach Beilein to Coach Howard?
Yeah, so, you know, I'll just start by saying the Michigan experience for the Washington family has been incredible.
Oh,
you know, and I will never take for granted that run that we had to San Antonio, because, you know, when you really step back and evaluate, there are a lot of folks that have been in this profession for a lot of years and never been the last one of the last two teams standing. And just the journey, the experience, the game, it's an incredible feeling. And once you get there, you want to get back again. And I believe that under Coach Juwan Howard, that we will be back again. But to answer your question, you know, Coach Beilein was a phenomenal coach. I always say Coach Beilein is like the master CEO, just in terms of like how he thinks about the game, how he prepares day to day so that everybody understands the expectation. We're all moving in the same direction. Both coaches are very big into player development. So that was like something that was really key to the heart of Coach Beilein. And then, you know, now transitioning with Coach Juwan, his career and all of our staffs, our current staff career, really birthed out of player development. And so with Coach Juwan, he is just an unbelievable connector of people, you know, and the way that people respond to him and connect with him. And so that has made recruiting, you know, really, really easy, but it also helped with the transition because, I mean, it wasn't like we were in a bad place, you know, from a program standpoint when Coach Beilein left it and went to the NBA. And so I think Coach Juwan and our staff did a really good job of reconnecting with this group and getting everybody to believe and be all in.
What was it like when Beilein announced that he was going to the Cavs? Were you in shock, or did you kind of see it coming? And
I would say, look, it was a variety of emotions going on that day because you know, you anticipated, you kind of heard some of the scuttlebutt going on a year before when the Pistons had their turnover, his name had been mentioned in that. And so it was an incredible opportunity for Coach Beilein, and he deserved it, you know, like over 40 plus years as a head coach at every level of the game, maybe one of the only people, if not the only person, to be able to make that claim. And for him and his family to be able to have that opportunity was great. And to be able to help him, you know, put him in position, be a part of a staff to help him do that was awesome. But then kind of like that week and a half gray period where you don't know who the next head coach is going to be. You don't know if you're staying, if you're going to have to, you know, relocate and look for another job. That was a little unnerving, you know, for a period of time. But, you know, as Don knows, I'm a believer, and I know I have my faith in God that, you know, however it was going to work out well for my family, for the University of Michigan, and I believe that it has.
Yeah, absolutely. I actually remember the day that it was announced that you were staying on staff with Coach Howard. I texted you and I said, hey, congratulations, Coach. You know, welcome back. And he's like, thanks, brother. But guess what? I never left.
That's all right. That's right. So, yep. Man, I got the same office. The key still works. You know, it's all good. But I appreciated it.
Yeah, absolutely. And the really cool thing with you, it's, especially with our podcast, you know, me and Connor met, and it's we've kind of taken off a little bit. Just the rivalry between Michigan and Michigan State is very heated, but also it's very friendly because really it's not like another state or another region. It's literally your next door neighbor, and you grew up in Lansing. Your father, Stan, was a star back in at Michigan State back in the mid '60s. Growing up on both sides of this rivalry, really, what kind of perspective have you kind of taken out of it?
You know, it's been awesome because not just family, but I got a ton of friends. You know, my younger brother is a Michigan State alum. So I always say I was born of Spartan blood, but you know, I bleed blue. Maize and blue. So, you know, it's the best of both worlds for me. And, you know, throughout my career, Coach Izzo and his staff, they've been great mentors of mine, great allies throughout my career, helping me get to this point. So, you know, of course, on game day, we want to kick each other's butt. But, you know, outside of that, you know, we're best of friends. I can text or call those guys at any time. But I think it lends to just the competitive nature that's the beautiful thing about, you know, collegiate sports and the very traditional rivalries that exist still between, you know, the two universities. And when you have, you know, two universities that compete at a very high level nationally, that makes it even more interesting, right? Because it's like this tug of war, this back and forth. And, you know, yeah, I'll be honest. There are some times when I want to unfriend some of my Sparty friends, you know, on Facebook when they get the popping off too much. But, you know, I think it's all healthy banter. And, you know, no one, I don't think at this point can really brag too much because it's been a pretty balanced rivalry thus far.
Yeah.
What's it like? I mean, you coached at Oakland, so you've faced Michigan State even before Michigan days.
Yeah.
What's it like preparing for a team like Michigan State?
Well, when I was at Oakland, when you prepare for them in at the Breslin, it was ridiculous because you have not only a great Michigan State team, but then you have the whole atmosphere of the fans and the Izzone and, you know, the wildness of having to go into that environment. We were always really successful against them when we played them on a neutral court, like when we played them at the Palace, you know, a few times and came really close. And so, yeah. You know, the 10 years that I was at Oakland and just coming up short, you know, year after year, when I finally came to Michigan, I was like, all right, it's time. And so when we got the first dub against the Spartans, like, I was like so fired up because it was like a long time coming, you know, for me personally. And so, and now, you know, again, it's just that natural rivalry that exists. It's fun. I enjoy it. Both programs embrace it. And it was a beautiful thing.
Does coaching against Izzo, seeing him fired up or like always in the rush years, does that drive opposing coaches nuts or what? I mean, I know fans can't stand it, but I want to know what a coach's perspective of that is.
I think we're all used to it at this point. You know, is who is, right? He's always going to be that guy. He's a fiery guy. But, you know, the guys that I've been with in D-line and right now with Coach Juwan, you know, they get fired up too. And so, you know, it's just like, man, just trying to will your teams and put them in position to win games you know, against your rival is the of the utmost importance. So there's never a lack of juice in the building when the Wolverines and Spartans meet.
I know Campy is kind of the same way too. He was always fired up. I've covered a couple of his games before. Yeah. He likes to get after the refs a little bit, which is, I'm sure that makes coaching against Izzo a little easier because you're used to that. But
Yeah.
I always wanted to know what the coaches thought of it. So that's good to know.
Yeah. I don't know what the referees always think of it, but you know, I think I love it. I love it because to me, that's what sports is about. It's about the energy. It's about the passion. And when you're passionate about what you do and passionate about the young man that you coach, you know, you're going to go all out for him.
Yeah, and I actually remember a couple of years ago, B-line I think was tossed like the first time ever at Penn State, and you took over. I'm like, I was just watching that game. I was like, Saddi, don't get ejected. Just don't get ejected, man. Just stay in the game. So so that had to have been because the officiating that night was atrocious. So I'm like, just keep your mind, pray.
Yeah, I'm glad you said it so I don't have to comment on it, but you know, it definitely was one of those nights where, you know, as an assistant coach, right, every assistant coach's job when your head coach starts getting fired up is to like be that
get back coach
kind of like get them calmed down or to back the referees up. But you know, that night Coach B-line had that look in his eye and was like, well boys, buckle in because it's gonna be a long night. And yeah, we played well. I felt like we played well in that second half and really had some chances to kind of get over the hump. And, you know, a call or two didn't go our way and kind of opened the game back up. But, you know, it was a very unique experience for me personally, kind of stepping in that role and trying to lead the team.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And really, I believe the first game, according to what I've seen, is next week against Bowling Green. Mm-hmm. Like, how are you feeling about this year's team? And, of course, you lose John Teske and Xavier Simpson, but you get Isaiah Livers back, which is massive. Mm-hmm. Franz Wagner was really starting to really come into his own, and I think he's ready to take that next step. It's just how do you feel going into this season?
You know, we've been preparing for so long. It's like, geez, let's just see a new face. It's about time. And every new year, you have a new personality of the team, a new identity. And until you get to that first game, you really don't know what to expect. You know, we've had some good practices. We've had some, you know, practices where we got to grow in some areas. But I think most first and foremost, everybody's just itching to get to that first game. And you know, I always say we're another day closer to playing a game, and hopefully God willing things align themselves that we'll get a shot at that next week against a really good Bowling Green team.
Absolutely.
How much have you been looking forward to this week? I'm sure this has been like, this has probably felt like the longest off season of all time. Probably feels like three off seasons rolled into one.
Yeah.
How much are you looking forward to this?
No, it's big time. I was just having this conversation with my wife last night. You know, we would probably be about five games into our non-conference season by now. Mm-hmm. And so you really do get to a point in your preparation where it's just like, all right, like we've got in what we're going to get in at this point, and now it's time to play. But the thing that kind of sucks is you're missing out on the scrimmages or the exhibition games where you can really kind of fine tune some things before you actually get into games that count. And that's really going to be interesting because I think it reflected early on, certainly in football, you know, with, you know, just, and not that they get exhibition games, but, you know, just going from 0 to 100, you know, without any kind of preparation to kind of iron some things out. For basketball specifically, I know we use those scrimmages and exhibition games to kind of see what kind of matchups work best together. What areas do we still really have to clean up before the first game, those type of things. So that's what makes these first couple non-conference games that much more critical, especially when you're playing quality opponents.
Yeah, we definitely saw that with football. I think Don and I were just talking about that, how, you know, Michigan and Michigan State, you know, they get these warm-up games that aren't really warm-up, but they're against, you know, inferior opponents from smaller conferences, and they just went right into Big Ten play with, you know, no practice, no spring, barely any fall.
Yeah.
So I can only imagine how that's going to be. And in your time as an assistant at Michigan, is this the deepest or toughest you've ever seen the Big Ten?
Man, I mean, last year was pretty doggone good.
Yeah. You know?
I mean, when you talk about, we would have probably had at least 10 teams in the NCAA tournament last year. And then when you fast forward to this year and you start looking at the schedule again, you're like, man, where do you find a win? You know, because everybody's good and everybody's brought back enough to be really competitive in the league. And then you factor in the uniqueness of probably more than likely limited or no fans, right, in the arena. So that really kind of takes out home court advantage of a lot of places in the Big Ten that really rely on those home court advantages. And speaking of, you know, we spoke about Chrysler, we spoke about the Breslin, but you know, you go some other places within the league, and it is like you can hear, you can't in Purdue, you can't even hear yourself think. You know, it's like, so that'll be interesting. I think this year is gonna, teams are really gonna have to bring their own energy, and where it will look or feel kind of maybe like a empty practice scrimmage type deal within the arena, even with the, you know,
fake noise.
But, you know, it's something to be said when you really have your fans really pulling for you, behind you, you know, giving you the energy to move forward. So we're all in uncharted territories right here.
Yes. We definitely are. In a normal year, what's the toughest place to play?
In the league?
Yeah.
Michigan State is tough. Wisconsin is tough. Mm-hmm. I would say anywhere Michigan is going is tough because we draw, yeah. The last couple of years we were ranked high. I just remember court stormings, in Iowa, Wisconsin.
Iowa fans are brutal.
Yeah.
No, Iowa fans boo at everything.
It's crazy. I mean, even like Penn State, has been a tough place to play. Rutgers. They draw really well. Fortunately, we played well at Indiana. So we were able to kind of take the crowd out in some of those in one game specifically, maybe 2 years
ago. Yeah.
When Jordan, Charles, Iggy, that group, we really played well.
Blasted them.
Early. Yeah, but I mean, Assembly Hall is like crazy. Like if you don't play well there, ooh, it's going to be a long night. And so you can't even really say that, like everywhere is really tough in the Big Ten.
I'll tell you one place where when Michigan State goes there, I just always have a bad feeling. One place, it's Purdue. Mackey Arena, always. Yeah. Like they could be the worst team in the league and they'll beat Michigan State by 25. It's crazy. Like last year, they beat them by like 30.
Yeah, no, it's tough. And it's crazy because when you pull up, typically when you pull up to the arena, and the bus lets you off next, you know, to go in the door. Like the fans are already wrapped around the building. So they're already like charged up. And then when you go in, they just have those concrete, you know, those concrete stands. So the sound just bounces back onto the court. And you can't hear yourself think out there. So it's challenging, but as a player, it's fun, you know, because that's what provides the juice.
Unless you're down early.
Yeah,
absolutely. So yeah, Saddi, do you have like one quick message before we part ways to tell Michigan fans and kind of keep them encouraged for this year and kind of get them ready?
Yeah, no, I would just say buckle up. You know, this is the year of the unknown, and we're going to control what we can control. We've had a really productive off season and dating back to the summer. Our guys are excited, you know, about getting out there and really competing. You know, coach, I always say this, Michigan is for competitors only. And so we want to get out there and compete and represent the league, represent our university, and represent, you know, the Wolverine Nation. So we're fired up and excited to go.
Absolutely. Well, Coach Washington, thank you so much for coming on the show. You're my friend and my brother, but also you are Michigan's assistant coach. I'm excited for you. I'm glad your dreams are coming true, and hope you stay at Michigan forever.
Yeah, I appreciate that. And Connor, are you from Michigan?
Yeah, I am.
So you are a Michigan man, right?
You kind of tricked me right into
you
that one.
You are a Michigan man.
I walked right into that one. I mean, I technically, sure.
There you go. Well, I appreciate you guys, and continue the success with your podcast and your listeners and your viewers. And as always, go blue.
Go blue.
Appreciate you coming on, Coach.
Take care.
Welcome back, everyone. This is the Podcast Divided. Saddi Washington, that is my old coach. Very, very funny story right there. All I did was shoot threes. I didn't know any other shot on the floor. But, hey, they every once in a while
they go work. In. If they go in, why knock it, you know?
Yep. Yep, I got pulled out the game for shooting too many threes. But, you know,
nothing like a fast break three to get yourself benched. That's for sure.
Oh, absolutely, man. And I had one of my coaches tell me that if you shoot another three, because I was like 0-for-5 from three in the first half, you shoot another three, you're out of the game. Second half, first open shot, I shot a three, nothing but net. Coach is gonna pull me anyways, but my assistant coach was, you know, like, hey, that was a good shot, keep him in. And so that was actually my last ever middle school game in the league championship game where we won. And at the end of the game, because it was on our home gym, a full house, it was middle school, eighth grade, had 15 points. And I was pulling out of the game in a blowout because we won our league championship. I actually went to the middle of the floor and I kissed it. I did it. Even though I was a Michigan fan, because going to that camp one summer during the Flintstones
spoke to you.
They influenced me.
Yeah. See, you had a little Sparty in you for a little bit.
A little bit. It's gone. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Now let's move on. Before we get on all that, let's move on to our Pick 10. As you can see the record, we are off and running. We are missing our partner in crime, Lucy. You know, she is in demand doing other things. We miss you. Moment of silence. Okay, it's over. yes. All right. Our Pick 10. Connor's got those games.
Yep. Yeah, let's start it off. Let's go to the Big 12 and start with Iowa State at Texas.
Oh, the darling of Michigan fans, Matt Campbell, right now. I don't know why. They're playing really well. Texas is tough to beat at DKR and down there in Austin. I think Sam Ehlinger at home will be the difference. It'll be a shootout because Brock Purdy and company can score as well. I'm going to take 48-45 Texas. Hook 'em points.
Okay. And Matt Campbell would be a great hire if Michigan was able to pull him, but I don't know if he's interested in that. Anyways, Iowa State playing really good right now. I think Brock Purdy is back. He's back. He had a really slow start to the season. Winning at Texas, like you said, is tough, but it's a different year. We don't see the same kind of crowds. They do have fans of games. But I think Iowa State just has a little bit too much with Breece Hall. I think they win by a field goal. So Iowa State by a field goal.
Oh, okay.
Shocker. Okay.
Well, she's not going to be happy with your pick.
I don't know. She might be happy with the next one. We're going Nebraska at Iowa.
Ooh, Iowa. Nebraska slander account. I'll never pick Nebraska. No. Iowa.
Iowa by 30. It's Nebraska is Nebraska this year. They are so bad that it's great. It's great for the sport. We're gonna go to another hated rival, Notre Dame at North Carolina. That's a top 25 game.
Shootout. I really believe that offense down there with Mack Brown and company is taking off right now. Notre Dame can score points. It's gonna come down to stops. I think Notre Dame's defense is going to be. Really involved and handsy. And I just really believe that they're going to really be a team to be reckoned with, you know, going down the way. At the same time, I want to pick Notre Dame, but I think it's going to come down to who has the ball last. Mm-hmm. I just have a feeling Sam Howell and company are going to upset them, and they're going to storm the field with 15% crowd. North Carolina Tar Heels.
I said it at the beginning of the month. I did a bold predictions for Notre Dame for the month of November. And I said that they were going to beat Clemson, but the one game they were going to lose was to North Carolina. I kind of am changing my mind a little bit because I think Notre Dame has a defense. North Carolina does not have a defense. Yeah. That's going to be the difference. Notre Dame is playing out of their minds right now.
They are.
I think the Fighting Irish win by 10.
Hey, fair pick.
It's going to be a good one. We're going to go to the Maryland Fighting COVIDs at Indiana.
Woo! Tully Tagovailoa for Maryland has really gotten his stride. They you know, I don't want to say they ran. They had a close game in Minnesota, but they ran Penn State out of their home, Happy Valley. So, but at the same time, I really believe. Of course, there's no such thing as a moral victory per se. That doesn't count in the win column. But I think with the way they fought and the way Tom Allen has them playing and has them believing, I just think they're going to take this Ohio State loss in stride, and because they were playing with house money last week, so I think they're gonna. I think they will win. I think they'll win by 14 points. I'm taking the Hoosiers, Hoosier Daddy.
See, that's kind of what I'm worried about. I think Indiana might have a little bit of a letdown because you know a game like Ohio State losing by 7 points after making that huge comeback. You know, it's heartbreaking. That can stick with the team, but Maryland hasn't played in a couple weeks, and they've had a bunch of guys out. I think that, you know, Indiana has just a little bit too much firepower. It's going to be an ugly game. I think it's going to be uglier than people think. It's not going to be like this high-scoring quarterback deal. It's going to be an ugly game, and I'm going to take Indiana by a touchdown.
Okay.
We're going to go to the Iron Bowl, Auburn at Alabama.
Ooh. Alabama. I just think that they have too much firepower right now. Auburn always plays well in this game, and they find ways to win, even though they don't have the talent that that Alabama has. With it being in Roll Tide land, and especially how it ended last year, where two pick sixes from my guy Mac Jones kind of made the difference. I think he's going to play a lot cleaner this year. With it being Alabama, I just think they're gonna roll them out of the stadium. Three touchdowns. Alabama, Roll Tide.
Yeah, I'm with you there. I think Auburn is the definition of a pretender this year, and Alabama is Alabama again, and Mac Jones is playing out of his mind. He's gonna have like 5 touchdown passes and they're gonna roll. I think they're gonna win big too.
Absolutely.
We have our staple Pac-12 game that we have to include because, you know, everybody's got to feel special.
Yeah.
We got Colorado at USC. That's the big game of the week in the Pac-12.
Colorado is the Fighting Mel Tuckers, as I'll call them.
Midnight Mels,
yeah. they've kind of had an offensive renaissance with freshman Brendan Rice at receiver. But with it being at USC, USC's continuing to play well. Give me the Trojans. Mm-hmm. Right on.
USC is going to add another unimpressive win to their resume, and they're going to be 4-0 with 4 wins that could easily be losses. USC is going to win and somehow move up in the rankings and be talked about with a fringe playoff team.
Yeah.
They're going to win. Back to the SEC, we're going to the Egg Bowl this time, Mississippi State at Ole Miss.
Clang, 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 clang.
Crazy ending last year, if you remember.
Man. Oh, of course I do, man. I've been to the Egg Bowl when I was in college in Mississippi. So that is the Egg Bowl is as nasty and as venomous of a in-state rival as there is. I mean, it's more venomous than Michigan State. And this is our podcast because that's all they got down there is Roll Tide. I mean, that works well. It's Hottie Toddy and Hail State. That's all they got down there. And I think from a venom standpoint, it's as venomous as Alabama. I believe that.
I believe that.
And it's in Oxford this year. I think Mississippi State has the defense, but Ole Miss has the offense, and it's in Oxford. It's going to be a high scoring game. I think the Pirates going to have his team playing, but
Matt Corral is a young man who's really I think it was Hugh Freeze actually. That wasn't Hugh Freeze. Yeah, it was Hugh Freeze or one of the recruiters down there poached him from Florida. Now he's there. I think he'll make the difference to Elijah Moore. And then you've got Jerrion Ealy, a young Jackson Prep star from Jackson, Mississippi, who my teammate, college teammate Shane Bennett coaches. I'm playing really well for the Ole Miss Rebels. Hadi Tadi Gosh Almighty, Ole Miss. I spent too much time there. So it's in.
Hey, you got to talk about, you know, your Mississippi friends and all you know about that. I agree with you. Mississippi State, I don't know if they have the defense, especially against Ole Miss. We saw Ole Miss score like 50 on Alabama or whatever it was.
Yeah.
They're going to put up 60. Matt Corral's going to throw for 500 yards. It's Elijah Moore is going to have another 200 yard receiving game. It's going to be a bloodbath. And I think Ole Miss is going to win this one pretty easily. I can't say easily because it's a rivalry. They're going to win this one comfortably enough. So I think Ole Miss wins this one. And yeah, I think they win the Egg Bowl. Staying in the SEC, LSU at Auburn. This one is always fun. This one's always fun.
Yeah. LSU, you sure it's Auburn?
No, LSU at Texas A&M. My bad.
I'm about to say, they already played.
Auburn's playing twice this weekend.
Yes.
Remember that.
Okay. LSU at Texas A&M. High-powered offense, Kyle Field. LSU, LSU has improved with their new quarterback. I don't think that they have enough to stop Kellen Mond down there and with the 12th man down there. I'm going with Giga Mags. Texas
A&M is so close to that fourth playoff spot that I think that they feel the pressure of needing to beat teams like this rather easily. LSU is just not the team they were a year ago. I think everybody knows that. Quarterback situation is better, but it's still kind of a mess. I think Texas A&M wins this one by 2 touchdowns.
I think so.
And now the time that we've all been waiting for, we're going to start with the JV team in the state. We're going to go Penn State at Michigan.
Oh, we're JV for the next year. I got it. Well, Penn State is – they're lifeless right now.
Mm-hmm.
They are lifeless.
Yep,
they're
a flopping fish.
They're just they. I'm shocked. Like, there's no fight. That's the biggest thing. Yep. They've lost. They've had injuries. They've got guys like Micah Parsons, who sat out for the year and all that. Sean Clifford's not playing well. I mean, it's a lot. Michigan has that shot in the arm they needed with the comeback led by Cade McNamara. It's at home. I'm going with Michigan, but I am concerned because Penn State does have some fast receivers, and they have a quarterback that can throw to those fast receivers. Mm-hmm. And if Michigan gives up some deep passes early in the game, it's going to be a very, very uncomfortable 3 hours for Michigan fans. But I'm going to go with Michigan.
I keep saying every single week, you heard me say it last week, there's no way Penn State starts 0-4, 0-5.
Yes.
Now I'm going to say there's no way they start 0-6, but there is a way. They're not good. They're terrible. Penn State's going to lose this game. And I think it's because they've quit on the season. It might be bad to say the kids might think differently. The kids who are playing might be like, we're giving it our all. They're not, they show very little life. And I think Michigan, like you said, they got that shot in the arm. I think that win over Rutgers, no matter how ugly it was, they got just a little bit of life back, and Penn State is lifeless.
Yeah.
So it's going to be, Michigan is going to win the toilet bowl this year, and it's not going to be pretty, but Michigan's going to win and pull back to 500.
Absolutely. That's the main thing. It's going to be, and with Michigan being a young – Michigan has talent, and they are very young. And confidence is everything to a young and talented team. And so I think that's going to make a difference. At the same time, just can't give those deep balls early. You do that, you're in trouble. If you don't do it, then it's smooth sailing. So, all right, let's go to the last game.
Varsity game in the state, Northwestern at Michigan State. Who you got?
Michigan State is not playing well. They had an extra week of practice and preparation, which will help, but I don't think it'll help enough. Northwestern is playing well. Northwestern's defense is very disciplined, and they're moving as one unit. right now, and Peyton Ramsey is playing really good football as a fifth-year senior. He's got experience. I think he was just what they needed. I think Michigan State's defense is starting to kind of find themselves as well. I don't see them scoring enough points. I've got 20-6 Northwestern over Michigan State.
Northwestern kills me every single year. I think that this game, I'm putting on my clown makeup as we speak. I go into this game thinking, you know, this should be a win every single year. And every single year, Northwestern does something that makes me look silly. This year, heading into the season, I thought this was going to be a sure win. Heading into this week, I think Michigan State's going to lose. I think that, like you said, the defense is better. I don't know if Northwestern's going to put up a ton of points. I think they're not going to 43-3 us like they did to Maryland. But I think they'll score just enough, and Michigan State's offense is a disaster right now. And if Peyton Thorne doesn't start, that'll be even more of a disaster. I think Northwestern wins by 10.
Yep, we're about the same there. Yeah. Well, that's college football. We got basketball tomorrow. So I'm looking forward to that. We got basketball, hockey, and football at the same time. So We've got some entertainment. Happy Thanksgiving to you and your family from us at the podcast.
Wear a mask.
And enjoy yourselves. There's plenty of sports on right now. They're not all good sport. Plenty of sports, plenty of entertainment. Got Christmas movies on. So stay safe. Wear a mask. Be responsible with your gatherings. Mm-hmm. So we can move on as a society, save lives. Please. And also we can finish this college football and college basketball season and college hockey, because Michigan's good in hockey this year. So that's it. Well, once again, thank you all so much for tuning into A Podcast Divided. We had a huge deluxe show today. No, this is our house, but you all are welcome to join and talk with us anytime. We will see you after the holiday and hopefully a couple of wins for the state of Michigan. Go Blue.